Hello and assalamu alaikum. This is lecture number 4 of the course Renewable and Alternative Energy Systems. And I am Usman Javed and I will be your course instructor. So, in this lecture, we will talk about the energy related terms which include levelized cost of energy, grid parity, net marketing, feed-in tariff and carbon footprints. Moreover, we will study about energy related emission trends, energy productivity trends, energy saving related to other fuels and electricity consumption, and the public investment in energy efficiency sector. So first of all, let us discuss about energy related terminologies. I will give a brief definitions about all of these and then we will go in detail. The first one is LCOE, levelized cost of energy, or the levelized cost of electricity. The levelized cost of energy is the measure of the average net present cost of electricity generation for a generating power plant over its time period of life. The levelized cost of energy is used to compare different methods which can be used for electricity generation on a consistent basis. The second one is the grid parity. It is also known as socket parity. It occurs when an alternative energy source other than fossil fuel is capable of generating power at a levelized cost of energy that is relatively less or equal to the price of power of the electricity that is being generated from electricity grid. This term is most commonly used when discussing about renewable energy sources, notably solar power and wind power. The third one is net metering. Net metering is a concept of billing mechanism in which the company or like in Pakistan Wabda, that it will credit the solar system or solar energy system owners for the electricity they add to the grid. For instance, if a residential customer has a solar system on his rooftop, he may be able to generate more electricity than he is using in home during daytime. The excess amount of electricity can be added in the grid and the company will pay the owner for his contribution in the grid. A payment made to households or businesses gathering their own electricity through the use of methods that do not contribute in the depletion of natural resources proportional to the amount of generated is called the feed-in tariff. And the amount of carbon dioxide that is released in our atmosphere as a result of activities related to energy production or energy generation is known as carbon footprint. Now let us go in the detail. The first one was levelized cost of energy, also known as LEC. The formula for levelized energy cost or LCOE is the sum of cost over the lifetime divided by the sum of electrical energy produced over lifetime. That is measured in dollars or euros per kilowatt hour. The second one was grid parity. The grid parity, the point at which the renewable and alternate energy sources REES, renewable and alternative energy sources, can compete with the existing power strategies without subsidizing or government support. That is known as grid parity or socket parity. It occurs when renewable alternative energy sources generates power at LCOE, which was in the previous slide, levelized cost of energy. Renewable energy sources are capable of generating energy at a lower price than the price provided by the grid power. Performance parity occurs when the renewable and alternative energy sources performance breaks the level of performance of existing technology. Means that renewable energy sources outperform the grid support. Next one is net marketing. The problem is when the house with solar power will generate electricity at the daytime, but it will not be capable of generating electricity in dark hours. So batteries must be installed in order to store the energy, electrical energy, that is being produced during day hours. So batteries will contribute towards the additional cost. So the solution to the problem is generate electricity from renewable or alternative energy sources and supply that extra power that is generated at that time to the grid instead of storing them in batteries. The electrical meter or the smart meter will keep the track and add negative units to customer bill for the supplied power. And the user can take power from the grid at night when the solar power or the sunlight is unavailable. This enables the consumer to use power generated from renewable energy sources anytime without employing the energy storage. And the consumer can generate more solar energy in daytime that it can use at night. Moreover, the consumer generating wind energy can consume it in future at the time of absence of winds. The next come is the feed-in tariff. The payment made to the households or businesses who have generated their own electricity through the use of methods that do not contribute in the depletion of natural resources, proportional to the amount of power they are generating. The first one, guarantee grid access to customers. Number two, offer long-term contracts to consumers. Number three, offer cost-based purchases. Owners paid in proportional to resources and capital expended to produce energy. Payment for installed capacity and annual electricity production, sometimes used interchangeably with net metering. Next comes the carbon footprint. That is the amount of carbon dioxide and carbon monoxide that are released into the atmosphere as a result of an individual or an organization that is contributing to produce electrical energy or any other form of energy. Carbon footprints are caused by burning fossil fuels, which includes diesel, petrol, and natural gas, etc. Measurement of greenhouse gases that one is responsible for creating. So this is your assignment number one. Here is some data. Rank wise, the country names China, USA, and India, and their total carbon footprint is given. You have to describe that which country in your opinion has the highest footprint, and summarize and justify the criteria on which you based your decision. These are the tables for year 2015. In your assignment, you may add the tables from 2020 or the period of COVID-19 in which the CO2 emissions have been significantly reduced, or in addition, you can perform the analysis when there were minimum CO2 emissions during the lockdowns as compared to the previous or past results. Now we will discuss the parameters indicative of energy impacts, which includes carbon dioxide emissions from fossil fuel combustions, the energy productivity, energy savings, and investment of energy efficiency and investment in energy efficiency and energy subsidies driven by energy policies. So let's see this graph. This is the graph of energy related carbon dioxide emissions obtained from the data points from the year 2003 to 2012, and on the right side the GDP, annual GDP is mentioned. The highest one is the graph of China. It is always higher. This is the graph from 2003 and 2012. If I discuss about the same graph, it was highest in 2013 to 2016 period also. and in China alone, the GDP expanded by an average annual rate of 7.2% during 2013 to 2016, compared with 2.6% average global growth and the 4% growth of developing economies. The China created more than 13 million new urban jobs for four consecutive years in 2013 and 2016. New jobs created in the first 8 months of this year stood at 9.74 million. Research and development expenditures rose to 52.2% from year 2012 to 1.57 trillion yuan in 2016. The share of research and development spending in GDP rose from 1.91 to 2.11% in the same period. So this indicates that higher the consumption rate of energy, the higher the GDP. Looking at this graph, Turkey, South Africa, Australia and Indonesia, these countries almost have negligible energy emission trends, carbon dioxide emission trend. Hence, the China has the biggest carbon footprint and these countries have the smallest. Now, see the energy productivity trends. Here, China is on the bottom and Brazil is on the top. So this is the energy savings relatively to fuel and electricity consumption in 11 IEA member countries. 11 countries include, I think, Brazil, China, India, Indonesia, Morocco, Singapore, Thailand, and in 2018, I think Mexico also joined IEA. International Energy Association stands for IEA stands for International Energy Association. Now this is the table of public investment in energy efficiency from year 2010 to 2013. So United States and United Kingdom, I think these two countries invested least, and they invested only in 2012. United States, US contributed, spent 5,140 million euros in utility programs, and UK, United Kingdom invested in Green Investment Bank in year 2012, and Germany I think is on the top with 10,315 million euros in 2010 in KfW. KfW is their bank that was formed in 1948. I do not remember what the KFW stands for. it's a German term. The bank was formed in 1948 after World War II as a part of Marshall Plan, and as of 2018 and 19 reports, it is the Germany's third largest bank by seeing the balance sheets. So Germans have invested over here 10,315 in 2010, 9,701 million euros in 11, 13,697 million euros in 2012, and 16,000 million euros in 2013. And on the second number is the Europe, which invested in European Investment Bank for public investment and energy efficiency report 2010 to 2013. They invested 2,200 million euros in 2010. 2011 they spent 1,300 million euros, and in 2012 1,100 million euros, and 2013 2,100 million euros. So these are the parameters indicative of energy impacts, energy saving impacts, future savings from proposed or recently implemented programs and policies measured in terawatts are